Okay, so what we're going to do today is, and what I will try to spend most of the time is really working in MATLAB. I have a few slides just to give some background and behind the model, the specific model that we will be implementing and analyzing in the beginning. So probably it will take a few minutes to introduce the system. And it's really an example that has been expired. The model that we're going to look today is being expired by neural modeling, and specifically the model that Hodgkin and Huxley developed in 1952. They aimed to explain the excitable behavior of neurons. In other words, the ability of a neuron to respond with increase in their membrane potential, or spike, or action potential, also known, and that they also developed technique to record. So they did this in a giant, I think it's a giant squid axon. It's not the axon that is giant, is the squid that is big. So it's a big animal that they took the nerve fiber, and then they recorded these behaviors. So this, as this first bullet point says, almost all biophysical models of neurons, but not just neurons, it's models of excitable cells such as pancreatic beta cells or cardiac cells or muscle cells are more or less based on this idea that Hodgkin and Huxley put forward in 1952. And this is the idea that won them the Nobel Prize for Physiology and Medicine in, I think it was in early 60s. So the basic idea is that they thought of representing the membrane of the cell as an electrical circuit, and where the capacitance in the circuit is configured in parallel with resistors here, which represent the various ionic currents that they postulated exist. At that time, they did not know that there are ion channels. Ion channels were discovered much later, but they were able to change the concentration of various ions inside and outside of the membrane and observe changes in these concentrations. And then they postulated that there must be currents that are flowing through to the membrane of the cell and organizing this behavior. So they came up with this equivalent electric circuit, and then using ideas from physics, they were able to write a system of equation that describes it. I thought there is a system of equation here, but it does, there isn't. I'll show you a system of equation later, just a basic equation. So the Morris-Le Car, the slide here for the Morris-Le Car, I decided to put a slide for Morris-Le Car because Kyle gave you last time a pre-coded model for this system. This is a variant of Hodgkin-Huxley. This is an example of using Hodgkin-Huxley formalism to model muscle cell. It has, as it says here, it has four state variables, and instead of having sodium current, if we can go back to this diagram, I should have mentioned that the main currents that Hodgkin and Huxley modeled were due to sodium and or mediated by sodium and potassium. And then they kind of represented everything else in terms of this leak current. And we all know, especially those of you who are biologists, we all know that there are many, many other ion channels and currents in the various neuron cells that are important and play a role in their behavior. In this initial version of the model, there was, this all was represented by this leak, which could be broken apart and detailed in various, could be made as complicated as one might want to. This is here probably is a point to mention that I see there is there is some, sorry, I'm stopping, but I see there is a chat message. Oh, Kyle says it's the giant axon of the squid. Yes, it's the giant axon of the squid. Thank you, Kyle. So I managed to respond to a feedback as well. I wanted to say a few words about biophysical models and phenomenological models and the big spectrum that exists. So although Hodgkin-Huxley model is roughly biophysical, it contains some biophysical detail. It also contains some phenomenological detail in terms of this leak current. And moving from very detailed biophysical models on the scale towards completely phenomenological models about which Kyle talked last week, we can go through a big spectrum of different levels of detail and complexity. And what I'm going to show as an example today is purely phenomenological model. That's what I'm getting at. The Morris-Lecar model in that sense is like Hodgkin-Huxley, very similar. The only difference is that instead of sodium, it has a calcium current, describing a current, a term in the equations that describes calcium current and does not include sodium current. Basically what Morris-Lecar did, they replaced the sodium current in Hodgkin-Huxley regional model with calcium. This is the equation that I was looking for earlier. Basically, what this model, this equation says is that the rate of change of the membrane potential is given by the sum of the various ionic currents that contribute to these changes in the membrane potential. And these changes could be spikes or trains of spikes or oscillations or action potentials, or they could be just constant depolarizations or hyperpolarizations where the membrane potential is either sitting at some high level of depolarized level or some low voltage level. And these are the main behaviors that this class of models exhibit. And these were picked up by Fitzhugh and Nagumo did their work separately. Fitzhugh was a mathematician working in the US. And what he did is use one of these old analog computers to analyze the original Hodgkin-Huxley equations using techniques similar to what I'm going to show you today. And we're going to do this in MatCont. Fitzhugh and Nagumo did this using the analog computer to produce simulations of the original Hodgkin-Huxley equations and also use mathematical concepts, which I will briefly describe later, to try to understand the dynamics that these equations produce. So this led him to the idea that in fact, these basic behaviors of spiking and constant voltage could be described very simply. This is now purely phenomenological description of this dynamics using two equations. One of them that we see here in blue is equation that describes the rate of change of a variable V, which you could think of as the voltage. It's, in other words, it's a fast variable. It evolves on a faster time scale. And here on the right-hand side, instead of having various sodium, calcium, potassium, or other currents that might be involved in the dynamics, Fitzhugh and Nagumo proposed that it could be replaced by a cubic polynomial, and this was justified by the fact that it captures qualitatively the behavior of the biophysical, roughly biophysical model. And then there is this parameter I applied that one can use to perturb the system, and it could be directly related to experimental situations where experimentalists, again, for those of you who are familiar with electrophysiology, they can apply current, and the current could be constant and could be of various magnitudes. So that's what we're going to use to probe the dynamics of the system. And this fast variable then is coupled to a slow variable or recovery variable. This is very phenomenological. I can't relate it to anything else. There are many equations in the original biophysical models that are lumped into this recovery variable, but it provides a slow time scale to the dynamics and couples the fast variable through this like linear function here, as you can see on the right hand side. So this is the model that we will be implementing in MatCon today, and we are going to use the ideas, the basic fundamental objects or concepts used in dynamical systems analysis in order to understand or to classify the behaviors that this system can exhibit. And here there is a list of those. For some of you, they may be familiar, other may not know what these things mean, but I will illustrate them as we, at least some of them. For example, the phase plane. This is really a representation of the solutions of this system or the behavior of the model in the space. In this case, it's a plane. We have a two-dimensional system that is spanned by the two variables, V and W of the model. And it is useful and instructive to look at that phase plane. And I will do this in a moment. And actually Kyle already did last time when he showed the simulations of the bracillator, he did show at the phase plane in one of the windows. Now clients are objects which we are not going to really see explicitly today, but they are very useful, and I will talk about this a little bit later. The steady states are really these constant levels that the membrane potential or the fast variable V takes for certain parameter values and initial conditions, and we will look at this in MatCont. And direction arrows, again, MatCont cannot visualize them, but this is really describing the flow, and I will give some intuitive idea about them later after we did some simulations first. So starting with implementing and simulating the Fitzhugh-Nagumo model in MatCont, we all need to open MATLAB. And now I lost MATLAB. Oh, here it is. So I'm not sure, maybe that in order to get feedback, I need to see everybody. So is it possible that everybody gives me some feedback that they have opened MATLAB like I have on my screen? Yeah, cool. So as Kyle said, in order to launch MatCont, you need to type MatCont in here, and that's what I will do. And it will pop up with Windows. And hopefully you all will see that first window. I'll wait a little bit to see if people have been able to open this. Well, it's on some many of you. So what we want to do is we want to create a new system. So we have to go to select systems and new rather than load a system like you did last time. So here is this window where we can put all the equations. And you all have seen this in Kyle's slides from last week. We need to define the name of the system, and I will call it FHN, that's Fitzhugh-Nagumo. Then the coordinates, these refer to the, this is all described in the slides. I'm gonna go a bit faster here in the previous slides and in the slides from this week. So the coordinates are really the dynamic variables, and they are V and W. So I'm putting them there. The parameters are I applied, which I discussed. And then we had A, well, phi first. Phi and A and B. These were the parameters, and time as by default denoted by T. And
Razi, there is a request to go slower.
Okay, thank you. So you're gonna give me, you don't tell me if there are requests. So what we did, we typed the name. So the name, define the name, that could be anything. Doesn't have to be FHN, could be something else, something that tells you what the model is about. It's purely up to the person that programs the model. The coordinates are the dynamic variables. If we go back to the PowerPoint presentation here, you see I have two equations, and I have dV dt and dW dt. So I'm putting these coordinates here, V and W. These are my variables. The parameters are the I applied, phi, A, and B. and I'm declaring them here in this line, and then time is t. And so I have the derivatives are something that relates to the analysis that Matkont does. For the moment, I'm not going to spend time discussing this, but if you have any questions at the end, we can talk about this. I will put the first three derivatives to be evaluated symbolically. This doesn't have to be the case. By default, the numerical option is there, and you can just stick with it. For more complicated biophysical models, perhaps it's better to stick with numerical derivatives here, because they are simple polynomials, the right-hand side, symbolic derivatives are appropriate as well. What I'm gonna do now is define the equations. And we have, as we see here, we have these two equations. I need to write these expressions now in MATLAB. So we have V prime, that's dV dt, equals V minus V to the power of 3 divided by 3. And I need to remind myself, minus W plus the applied current. So that defines the first equation and semicolon. The second, W prime, is equal to phi times bracket V plus A minus B times W. So I have V, well, we see it moved because I'm switching windows. So it's V minus A plus B times W and semicolon. And I'm gonna double check that this is what it is. No, it's plus A minus B. So I'm gonna change this to plus and minus B. So now I have defined the equations and I have checked that they're correct. And I'm ready to click OK. I see there is a lot of feedback coming here, but I'm not sure what it is in the chat.
Yeah, sorry, it's just someone is saying that they can't find the window to get to where you are now.
Okay.
So if you just...
So this is, yeah, I can show. So do you see the main Matkont GUI window? If you do, you need to go to Select, System, and New. Is this working? You see what I did? I hid all my windows now. So I have to come here and show them again. That could happen to all of you at any time.
We had confirmation that it worked, and now people are catching up with the equations.
Okay, so I'll stick
with... There is a question about the cases, and yes, in general, MATLAB is caring about the cases, because you crazy have a capital W and a lowercase W.
Well spotted. I have to make it small, and I just did. Yeah, that would have been an error, and probably would have caused me trouble.
Yep.
Okay, so, well, I think that window will be there. If I click, no, it's gonna go away if I click OK. So if I can make sure that everybody's got to the stage, then I click OK. I now lost them. I haven't lost them, they're behind the main GUI. Sometimes it's very annoying, and what I do is I just minimize this, and that's what I'm going to do now.
Okay, Jen pasted the equation, so yeah.
Okay, so now it's important when I click OK, the MATLAB will compile this information and create the model, basically something similar to what Kyle, or part of what Kyle sent you last week. And this will disappear, and the model will be created. See, it has pre-compiling model. And now this has happened. And here the main control window is telling me that the system is Fitzhugh-Nagumo, and I have set up the derivatives here for symbolic, the first three and the fourth and the fifth to numerical, and the various other options here that Carl has described very clearly in his slides from last week. So the next step is to perform some simulations. Now we're confident the MATLAB hasn't given me any errors, so it should be, hopefully, it should be programmed correctly. So what we could do next is perform simulations. And here in my PowerPoint presentation, there is a description of how we go about it. So to simulate the Fitzhugh-Nagumo model, we need to start by clicking type initial point. These are simulations from a predefined initial condition. In other words, values for the two variables, V and W. You will see what I mean. Did this happen? Okay, now it opened the window. So you should see this window's opening, starter and integrator. So now we're after simulating the model starting from an initial point. And we need to set some settings here to assign values to the parameters and initial conditions to the variables V and W. They're zeros, and I'll let them be zero, and then we'll change as the simulation goes to some other starting conditions. If you remember from the PowerPoint presentation here, we have A 0.7, B 0.8, and phi 0.7. So we need to type these here to assign values to these parameters. This is 0.7 as well. So we have phi 0.7, A 0.8, and B 0.7. No, A 0.7 and B 0.8. It's not that important, but it's good to simulate exactly the same model that I have on the slides. The applied current I'll keep for the moment at zero. We're going to change it later and see what happens. The initial conditions for V and W are zeros as well for this particular simulation. And we want to start from time zeros. We need to tell the software for how long we want to simulate. This is here given in that setting interval. We want to simulate for much longer than one. One time step is really short time. So I would do something like 200. The rest of the settings could stay the same. So what I just did is I assigned values to the parameters phi, A, and B in the starter window. And I also told the MatCont, the simulator, for how long I want the simulations to run. And
so the question is, there is a question like, you know, what's the interval actually means? Is it like a second or is it time steps?
That's a very good question. It's time steps, and it depends on the time step of the solver, which in this case is OD45, and it by default has some time step, which actually I'm not sure if it is adaptive in its implementation in MATLAB. If it's adaptive, it will be changing.
Yeah, this is adaptive.
Yeah, it will be changing the time step as the simulation goes along, depending on the properties of the solution, whether it's very stiff system or not. These are actually numerical details. But the bottom line is that 200 is numerical simulation time. And in these phenomenological models, unless I assign units to my parameters here, A, B, and phi, it doesn't have its arbitrary units. It's time, but it's not seconds or minutes or hours. The in order to interpret the numerical time for the simulation into some time units in from real life, like seconds, milliseconds, or minutes, you need to have units or parameter values in your model that have units, that have physical units. And this is the case of Hodgkin-Huxley, but not in the case of Fitzhugh-Nagumo. So basically, the meaning here is purely numerical time. So did everybody manage to get to this stage in putting the parameters and the duration for the simulation?
We got some confirmation that yes.
The next stage is to open windows where we want to visualize. And this is done by clicking on window output in the matcont, main matcont window, graphic. And then you can choose 2 or 3D plot. This model is two dimensional. We have two variables, V and W. So 2D is the appropriate visualization. So I'll create 2 of those because I want to look at simulations in time as well as in the phase space that I mentioned. So I click this twice and I get 2 plots, 2D plots. This is similar to what Kyle had last time when he was simulating the brassulator. He had simulation in time as well as simulation in the phase space in his demonstration. We need to tell Matcont what's on the axis in these 2D plots, depending on what we want to plot. By default, it puts them in the phase space, basically chooses for X and Y, V and W. That's the default setting. We can change it from Matcont layout. That opens this little window. And we can see that on the x-axis we have V, on the y-axis we have W, and here is the range. By default it's from 0 to 1, but I want to change this to be from -2 to 2, just based on previous knowledge of the behavior of this model. However, if you don't know, there is an option later to fit the plot to illustrate the trajectories that being computed automatically. So this could be done at a later stage as well. But I'd like to set them now to -2 to 2 for both variables. And I will do exactly the same for the other window, but set it to show me the solutions in time. Instead of having V here on the x-axis, I want to choose T. And in order to do that, I need to change from coordinates to time. Now it's T. And the range here, since I want to simulate for 200 steps, I have to change this 1 to 200. And on the y-axis, I want to have V rather than W, although it is okay if you want to visualize W as well. And here I will set this to -2 to 2. Okay. Do we have feedbacks?
Everything looks fine at the moment.
Okay, so I'm gonna click okay. Now I have set up my both windows and I have set up my initial conditions and parameter values, and I have told
thumbs
how...
ups and yes, so yeah, people are following, yeah.
Great. I have also told for how long I want to simulate, so now I can...
Crazy. Sorry, there's just one quick question. So can you just remind everyone what's plotted on the graphic windows?
Yes, so I can repeat that. So the first plot, T and V, will show me the solution in time, basically the behavior of... the variable V, we can think of it as a voltage, and how it changes over time. And the plot, the second plot, second window that says VW, I'm looking at the phase space that I mentioned earlier. This is how the trajectory looks in the plane that is spanned by the two variables V and W. So one of them, this is the phase space, and this is the time series plot. To produce these plots, I need to click on, trying to adjust my window so that they don't sit on each other. So I need to compute forward. That's all I need to do, since I have set all the rest of the settings. So compute forward will produce now a solution simultaneously in both plots. It says computing, and I can see that here I see something that started from zero. This is the initial condition for V, and then went down and then settled to some constant value for V. It's, in other words, it's a steady state. It's a fixed point. All these are used interchangeably, and you can visualize this or illustrate this in terms of time series solution as just a constant line. In the phase space, I think it's far more interesting. We have this kind of semicircle that started here at 0, 0 for V and W, and then it went as time goes by. So time is not shown here, but it's implicit in the way this got created. I will create some more until it reached this point here and stopped. And this is that equilibrium point that corresponds to this constant solution. And basically this first bit here that you see is literally somewhere up to here. It's the time that it took to come here. And after that, it basically stayed in that point, which is the fixed point. So, and you can't visualize the time in the phase plane, but you can clearly see the trajectory converging to a point and staying there. And no matter how long I will continue these simulations, nothing's gonna change in the phase plane. And in the time series, you will just see a constant line continuing in time. So with this first part of simulations, well, I probably pause here and ask if there are any questions.
So if you could, let's say, press yes to confirm that you managed to run the simulation, that would be very helpful. Okay, yeah, we've got confirmation.
So the next I want to do is change these initial conditions to something like two for both variables. So now I'm gonna be starting somewhere here in the phase plane. Thank you. So what we'll do now is just compute starting from V and W two for both. So it's exactly the same. I'll compute forward and we will see a trajectory on the screen. It's interesting it didn't show two, but so now it's completed. I did mention we can fit range, and now I can see what the trajectory did. It started here, that's in the phase space, at 2, 2 as initial condition, and then did this big excursion and converged to that same fixed point, which has coordinates -1.1994 for V and -0.6251 for W. And I can, no matter how many times I can change the initial condition several times and compute these trajectories, they will all be converging to this fixed point by spiraling for a while until they reach this point in the phase space, which is the steady state or the fixed points. Basically, for this set of parameters, for apply current zero, what the system does, it settles at a constant voltage. And I'll quickly do one more, starting from -2, 2, just for illustration. Now changed V and W and compute forward. And you can see one more trajectory now coming from below and to this point. And I can fit range again and visualize this as well. And so that's how these three solutions look in the phase plane. And I want to zoom to point out something, how that's how they look into. We can zoom onto the, oh, I better fit it now. So if it happens to you, you can always fit. I wanted to zoom here on this bit to illustrate the initial, how depending on the initial conditions, you can get something that looks like a spike, or you can just see this decrease in V and then settling to that fixed point, which is this. And we can check this. Here are the coordinates, and if you come here on this point, which is going back to the cursor, I need to fit the range again. These values here are exactly the same. It's not, I need to take this arrow. Yeah, so I can then visualize. I don't know why it's not doing it, but if you click on this thing like I do here, and look at the values, they're exactly the same as these values for V and for V. The time is whatever time we have on the x-axis. So, any questions? Or feedback? Is it okay to move on?
I think so.
Yeah. So I'm going to clear this because now what I want to do is change the applied current. So I'll clear this and this. So clear basically removes all the and here I'll make sure that my initial conditions, I want to start from 0, 0, although it could be other values. And I want to produce the solution for the applied current 0. Just repeat the same thing. We go forward and we see this as we saw before, steady state. So if I increase the applied current to 0.5 and do compute forward, I'll see a trajectory that wiggles a little bit and then converges to steady state. This was the second here trajectory. It's a different steady state compared to this one. So now changing to 1. Computing forward, show me another solution, which is now very different. We have sustained oscillations in time. And in the phase space, we have this closed curve, which corresponds to these oscillations here in time. And the amplitude of V is roughly near 1.5 and minus 1, a little bit below minus 1. And you can see here, it goes from about minus 1, the closed curve, up to around 1.5. And this is, if I continue solving in time, I will see more oscillations in this plot if I extend it. But in the phase, I'm not going to see anything else, just this closed curve, because the solution is now on the attractor. That's what's known as an attractor. And now if I change this to 0.5, the applied current here, and compute one more trajectory, what I will see is now the system converging to a high level or high value of V, a fixed point or a constant. In time solution, I can fit here this to visualize all of these three solutions. So basically we have this fixed point down here. This is the next fixed point down here, up here. Then we have the closed curve, which is the oscillation. And then we have the upper steady state solution, which is this point here. So what this shows is that by changing the applied current, this model does behave like an excitable cell, a neuron or a muscle. If you stimulate it, that's observed over and over again. If you increase the level of stimulation, usually the cell will start responding with oscillations and then eventually settle into something that's known as the polarization block. That's this high value of the voltage represents this behavior observed in experimental systems. So are there questions or it is a shame I can't see the chat, but I don't see it going. I can't see the feedback as well. Did everybody manage to plot this?
I managed to, and in the chat there was just a couple of questions, but that people have answered. So,
okay,
I can't see any anyone who's stuck.
Yeah. So basically, what we did is pretty much repeated what Kyle did last week, and this takes me to the next part of the presentation. So here there are a few slides going over the steps that I just showed you. Simulating this model and plotting these trajectories with some detailed instructions. So I'm just going to spend a few minutes telling you a little bit of how we can use mathematics to make sense of these behaviors. What I also wanted to point out is that it's very instructive when you are implementing a model and simulating it to do this, to carry out the steps. And I'm sorry if I'm repeating something that you all know, to carry out the steps that I just did, to get a feel of how the model behaves if you change parameters or initial conditions, because in some, especially more realistic and more complicated models, it could be that the system will be much more interesting. Well, this one is probably already interesting, but it could be that you sometimes find different types of solutions if you change the initial conditions, or you converge to different types of oscillations or steady states, depending on combinations of parameters. So this is always useful exercise, what we just did. So how do we make sense of this? I talked about the phase plane, and we saw solutions plotted in the phase plane. There are these two other objects, which are nothing else but the plots of these functions on the right hand side. So we have that cubic polynomial, which is this blue line, and that linear function of W, which is that red line. So these two objects, which one can easily plot in MATLAB or in any other plotting software, have special position in the phase plane, and the intersection of these gives that steady state or these fixed points that we observed. And the properties of these fixed points then could be analyzed using concepts from dynamical systems theory, such as Jacobian and eigenvalues. These are, for those of you that are not familiar with this, I will repeat again, don't worry. For those that are familiar, they will understand perhaps what I'm trying to illustrate here. The point is that we can use some mathematical constructions and mathematical theory in order to get an insight into the behavior of this system. And what this really boils down to is these eigenvalues that are computed from this Jacobian matrix. And these eigenvalues, the nature of these eigenvalues, tells us the properties of the fixed point or the steady state. And in this case, as you can see here, we have complex conjugate with negative real parts, which, according to the theory, tells us that the steady state is a stable spiral. And that really explains the behavior that we saw in the phase space when we stimulated with applied current equal to zero. When you simulated the system using this applied current equal to zero, we saw these trajectories that were spiraling around and converging to the fixed point. And this is here an illustration in the phase space. Starting that blue dot, that blue black dot here corresponds to the initial condition and the trajectory. So starting from some initial condition, which is on the right of this blue curve, and simulating in time produces a little trajectory that converges to this fixed point and starting on the right side of this blue curve, now Klein, we produce a trajectory. So we make a bigger excursion and converge to the steady state. But no matter where we start, we always will eventually end up at the steady state if we don't change the applied current, as we saw in the simulations. And what these objects here in the phase space tell us is what we would expect, how big, in other words, the excursion will be before reaching the steady state. And this has its experimental or biological relevance. It is known that some cells will respond differently to the same amount of applied current or under the same conditions. And this relates to something called all or none response. You see here almost no response, and here we have a big spike. And that's then being related to information processing in the brain and various other properties of these systems. Applying current, as we saw, when we set the applied current to one, we saw oscillations. So these oscillations can also be understood in terms of these theoretical considerations. So in this case, the steady state of the system is unstable because the real part of these eigenvalues here is positive. The fixed point is unstable spiral. And this is really due to the fact that blue curve, which is the Wien-Auk line, has shifted up by adding one to the right-hand side of the V equation. And now the intersection with the red line is happening at some higher values for W. And if we are to simulate now from various initial conditions, we will see these closed curves in the phase space, no matter where we start from. Eventually, the trajectory converges to a limit cycle, which in time looks like an oscillation. And these arrows here, the motion in the phase space is referred to as direction arrows or a flow. So basically what we just witnessed by changing the applied current and a qualitative transition between a stable constant solution and oscillation is one way to think of bifurcations. So bifurcation or tipping point also quite fashionably these days called tipping points. Some tipping points are bifurcations. Are parameters, specific parameter values at which the system changes its qualitative behavior. In our example, the qualitative change is from a stable fixed point to a stable oscillation. And this could be summarized, these behaviors could be summarized using a notion of a bifurcation diagram. This is another plot, but instead of having time or state variable on the x-axis, we have the parameter of interest. In this case, it's the applied current. So here, if we now position the applied current on the x-axis and one of the state variables on the y-axis, in this case V, we can summarize the behavior using the behavior of the model and the dynamics using bifurcation diagram. And this is a sketch, and hopefully I'll have some time to show how you do this in MatCont. MatCont is able to do that. Also MatCont, I should have pointed out, computes the eigenvalues. One can look at these as well if interested. But basically what we have here is a summary of what the behavior of the system will be if we change the applied current. So for low, small values of applied current, we just have these fixed points. And we saw that when I changed the applied current from 0 to 0.5, the system equilibrated at a higher V. And that's what's kind of illustrated here. We have gradual increase in the level of V, constant level of V that the system attains after a long period of time. for some values of the applied current. And eventually, when I increase the applied current to Y, the system started to oscillate. And here this is represented by this dash line, which is the unstable fixed point. The oscillations are not given here, but I'll show them to you on the next diagram. And then eventually, if I increase the supplied current further, we get to that high depolarized state. So that's what MatCon can compute. And I will try to illustrate how this is done in the remaining time. But now we'll pause and see if there are any questions.
There's nothing in the chat.
That's good. Either very clear or very confusing. But hopefully if we could, well, so no, basically now going back to what I was trying to describe, for I zero, we were here. For I 0.5, we got a little bit higher in V. Then for I equals one, we started to oscillate. And then when I put I to 1.5, we came to that solution, which is the higher value of V, which is constant again. That is what I was trying to explain by showing you this diagram. This is a summary. Obviously this here is plotted as a continuous curve covering a big range of values for I. But if you imagine, if I say I equals zero is here, and then I equals 0.5 is here, and then I equals one is maybe here, and 1.5 is somewhere here. And then I have these snapshots in time of the behavior and in phase space. Okay, so move on to the bifurcation analysis. I did mention that we could look at these eigenvalues and other numerical quantities that are associated with this analysis, and this is basically done in this numerics window. From layout here, you can see at the moment there's only coordinates, parameters, and time, but when I switch to a continuation simulation, then we will be able to see eigenvalues and others. So let's do this step by step. So first I want here to clear these ones. Then I want to converge to a steady state, and that's important because we will be starting our bifurcation diagram from some initial value for I. I'll choose I equals zero here again. So I need to make sure that my V and W have values that correspond to this steady state or fixed point. And one way to do that, I can plug them there because I know them and we already saw this. I can type them, but I can also compute a trajectory forward, and that will produce these values here. So then I can tell the software to use them as initial conditions for my continuation in the parameter of interest, which is the applied current. I'm pausing because that's a quite important step. And to get this continuation in parameter right is extremely important to start with the solution and stable solution preferably that corresponds to this parameter value. In our case, this is the applied current. So basically what I need to make sure is that my V and W have values that correspond to the steady state solution in time for applied current equals zero. And that's what I did. I computed this now. The next step is to tell MatCon that we need to choose it as the initial condition. And I can do that from the control view results. And I want to choose the last point, which is that steady state. Here are these values. And I select that point, and this now automatically plugs them here. So that step completed, we need to change the type of the simulation that we are doing. So far we were computing trajectories, solving the system in time, starting from an initial point, or solving initial value problem. What we need to do now is define a different type of simulation that starts from equilibrium, which is that steady state. And that's why I need to type initial point equilibrium. I'll pause here for those of you who are still following in MATLAB, so you have time to do this change. Not having any reactions.
So if you've managed to get to this point, if you could click yes, that it would be very helpful. Thank you.
And if not, it's fine as well. You can just watch me, but it's good to know in any case.
Yeah, we have a couple of yeses. The number of yeses is growing.
So I'm going to this, I'm choosing this equilibrium, and that's an important step because it will change some of the windows now. So when I choose equilibrium, we see that the starter and the continuer now changed. And this is because I'm now doing, I have told MatCon that I'm going to be performing continuation, what's known as continuation, or in other words, computing the bifurcation diagram. So the continuer has a lot of settings. The layout has changed as well. Now I can choose eigenvalues, for example. And here are the real and the imaginary parts. The starter is an important one. Here, we have this initial point, the equilibrium point that I've chosen, but I need to tell the software which is my parameter of interest. And in this case, it's the applied current. So I need to click to indicate that I'm going to be computing a bifurcation diagram using the applied current as bifurcation parameter. I see three more notifications or comments.
No, it was just like, you know, about catching up with the things that have been missed in the previous steps. Gemma, have you changed the I up to zero?
Yeah, the problem is the V and W for me.
They are not these values?
No, I missed something. So I went to the control window and I viewed the result, but I think...
Oh, you didn't pick up the point. So, but don't worry. This can be, in some sense, step over. You can basically type them there.
Okay.
You can type these values there. If your starter is open, and you can just literally do what I haven't. You don't need to type them to that high numerical precision. 1.1992 probably sufficient, or 3, okay. And 0.62443, something like that.
Okay, that's great.
Hopefully sufficient. I'm saying sufficient. If you get an error, we'll know that this is because of that. The continuer has a lot of settings here. And I will recommend keeping them with the default ones for the moment. It does work for the system. If the system is a bit more complicated and more stiff, some of these numerical settings may need to change. But from my experience, it's a matter of experimenting. So if the default don't work, then usually some of these tolerances and precisions need to be increased. So here there are steps as well, but what's important here to understand that these steps now are not in time, because we are not simulating anymore in time. We are not solving initial value problem. What we're doing here is we are continuing a equilibrium solution as a parameter of the system changes. So basically we're getting this map of the solutions of the long-term behavior of the system as a function of the parameter. So these steps here refer to steps in the parameter value. In our case is I applied. And these settings are pretty good here. They could be decreased or increased if there are issues with the continuations. Probably if you have opened this for the first time, your maximum number of points is probably 10 or something. this tells MatCont how many steps to take, similarly to the interval and integrator window. However, these are steps in the parameter value. It's good to increase this to something like 300, could be even bigger or smaller, to make sure that you can cover a range of I applied values. Okay. So one last thing I need to do is change the layout here, because now I want to plot a graph that has the parameter, a parameter I applied in this case, but I can choose any other one, on the x-axis, and the range for I applied be from 0 to 2. If you remember, I changed it in the time series simulation from 0 to 0.5, 1 and 1.5, and I saw all these changes in behavior. So 0 to 2 is sufficient range. And for V, I will set it to be minus 2 to 2 as before. So now I have a 2D window where I'm ready to plot the bifurcation diagram. I will leave the phase plot there as well. So I think I've done everything, but I'll just double check with my, I've done that. So we can now compute the bifurcation diagram by clicking as usual on compute and forward. And you can see this line here appearing and stopping at this H that denotes hop bifurcation. That's what the system, the default settings are. The continuation stop when they detect a special point or a bifurcation. So I just need to click resume to continue. And then it detects another hop bifurcation. So stopped again, and I will click continue. And now I have covered the range from 0 to 2. And it continues, it's out. It's not relevant because basically what the system does, it just, there is just a fixed point. I can stop this. So basically the interesting behavior is around here between these two hop points. So we have computed now a branch of equilibria for the Fitzhugh-Nagumo model as a function of the applied current using MatCont. That's the first step in performing bifurcation analysis. And although it's not shown here as a dashed line, we know that there was change of stability because of the change in the eigenvalue, the real parts of the eigenvalues from positive to negative. So we have negative real parts, positive real parts, and negative real parts here. So between these two hop points, the equilibrium is unstable. I see a reaction. Is it a question?
No, I think we have some confirmation that people that computed the curve.
So the last step will be to actually compute the branch of periodic solutions by starting now at a hop bifurcation where we're branching out and we can visualize the periodic solutions. And this is all here in the PowerPoint presentation. What we need to do now is pick the hop point from this control window. If I do view results, you can pick any of the points. Usually makes sense to pick the first one, but in some situations it might be better to pick the second one. If you are performing such analysis and if you pick the first hop point and it doesn't work, I would recommend redoing the equilibrium curve and then picking the second hop and trying to compute a periodic solutions, branch of periodic solutions from that second hop. I'll do the first. It did work when I tried it earlier. So I was selecting this point. By selecting this point,
Grazi, can you tell again how you got to the results window?
From control, this panel here, view results.
I think that will be helpful, yeah.
Yeah. I think there is another way to get to there. But I have forgotten
where. Yeah, I think if you go into the select and then point, you have to select the curve first.
Yeah. And then, you can see that window. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you, Kyle. So whether you do it from that control window or from the main select from mat content and select curve, what it does by selecting the hop point, basically here it plucked the values of V and W that correspond to this hop point. That is what happened. And the value for the parameter I applied at that hop point, we can see it's roughly just 0.6. We can see it here. So now having done this, we are set to compute the periodic branch, which will come out of that hop point. It detected a bifurcation, so I need to click resume again. It's now computing. You can see here in the phase space, a little periodic orbit starting to grow. So basically you see a family of periodic orbits coming out of this Hopf bifurcation. This red curve now represents unstable periodic orbit. If I continue, the blue are stable and they grow in amplitude. This closed curve become bigger and bigger. And we can see here how they look like as I applied now increases. And this is the minimum and the maximum of the oscillation if you are to plot these solutions in time. And this will continue now either until it detects another bifurcation or a special point, or until it runs out of maximum points to compute. Well, I think is now our case. It seemed to finish, but I can see that it hasn't finished yet. So I'll basically do compute, extend, and it will continue for another 300 points, which is a lot more than what we need. I'll stop it at some point just to make sure that now we can see here how it comes back. It closes back onto itself because it's converging to the steady state, going through an unstable periodic solution. Oh, and I need to resume in order for this to continue. And it keeps closing and it will become eventually as small as a point. And then we know it's gone back to the second hop point. Not sure how many of you followed these bits, but I see a lot of comments. You'll be able to redo this yourself. There are detailed instructions in the PowerPoint presentation. If there are any questions, we have a few more minutes.
Can I just make one small point? So Krasny, if you go into the options thing and the main MatCon GUI and click on suspend computation.
Yes, I know. Yeah, you can then choose where you want it to stop.
Yeah, so you don't have to hit resume every time it finds something like a hop for.
At the moment it's set to be, that's the default setting, to stop at special points, which are bifurcations. You can make it stop at each point, which is really annoying because then you have to click resume all the time. It did happen to me. Or never, which it means it's just going to carry out and compute the various objects until it runs out of points, like until it reaches, in this case, 300. Another thing I wanted that I think is quite interesting to see is zooming here, just around the Hopf point and seeing something which Piotr is going to talk about next week. That's why I want to zoom. We can actually see here that there is a very tiny range between I applied 605 and I applied 0.61, where there is a fixed stable point solution and a stable oscillation. So it's a very small region in the applied current where the system is bistable, and that would be the main topic of the next session, where Piotr will show different examples of bistable systems found in biological problems, and show how these things could be computed and analyzed using MATLAB. But we also have it here, although it's a very tiny range. It's probably insignificant from biological point of view. And I even have some final slides here, schematically show this bistability, where we can, depending on the initial conditions, we can either converge to a constant solution or to an oscillation if we are in that range of parameter values. And it's important because in experiments, what one will see is, depending on where they start or what's the initial state of the system, they might record nothing, in other words, constant behavior, or they might observe oscillations just purely depending on the initial condition. And that's what happens in bistable or multistable systems. And it's an area which is quite interesting and relevant for biological and other experimental systems. So 3 minutes, if there are any burning questions. I see a lot of comments.
I think it's okay.
Maybe I can stop share screen so that I can see these comments myself. Because at the moment I can't really see them. Now I can see the chat.
So I guess like before, like, you know, if you have had any problems with the GUI, and then, like, you know, with the slides are not helpful in getting you through the bits that you've missed or didn't manage to follow, just drop us an email, and like, yeah, I will be happy to organize one-to-one short session to smooth out things.
And I will make these slides available as soon as we finish right now. So you will get a link to the PowerPoint presentation. And as Piotr said, if you have any questions, we are all very happy to help. Actually, if you have a real system that you want to implement and you run into trouble or get some errors, please feel free to contact us. It's actually interesting for us, because we discover new bifurcations and things as people look at different models. So it's very interesting.
I don't know if Yolanda has a question.
Yeah, I do. Firstly, Prezi, thank you so much. That was amazing. And I learned so much. It was fantastic. Thank you. I was wondering, if you have a more complex system, can you observe the stability of it? Say, if you've got a system of 4, 5, 6 coupled equations.
Yes, you have to very carefully inspect the eigenvalues to make sure, because obviously we have only two variables here. So the choices, you know, you can either have two of them negative or two of them positive, or one positive, one negative. If you have more state variables, then you have many more combinations. The stability could be, so basically you can be unstable, less or more. You can just have only one positive eigenvalue and be not so unstable. Basically in the big phase space, you have only one unstable direction, or you can have manifolds of unstable manifolds that span 2 or 3 dimensions, and then the system can behave very interestingly. So the analysis is a bit more involved, but yes, you could do that. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much all. If you have any questions, please get in touch and we'll make all the presentations available, and happy to answer questions. See you next week. Bye.
Bye. Thank you, Prezi.
Thank you.